Our interdependent and globalized world challenges our views and conventional wisdoms. For some, this provides opportunity to grow and benefit from the wonderful diversity that our globe offers to us. But by some, this is seen as a threat to their worldwide worldview, which they hold to be supreme. The cost of fear-mongering and spreading hate is simply too high. For many, it is a matter of life and death. So it is simply essential. It is not any more luxury to kind of get together in these kind of settings and learn about each other, but essential that people of goodwill get together and come together and talk and have these conversations that matter. That's great. It is only through a grassroots effort at getting to know one another and understanding the foundations of each other's traditions and ideologies that we can hope to dispel false images, misconceptions, and stereotypes about each other. At Abrahamic Initiative, we believe that healthy and constructive relationships will emerge from mutual understanding and appreciation of each other's traditions. Therefore, our mission is to foster mutual understanding and appreciation among Abrahamic faith traditions and beyond through education, dialogue, and social action. Today's event is organized to provide us all an opportunity to learn about a very contentious and majorly misunderstood, at least in America, Islamic concept of Sharia. And we're pleased, really, to have Haroon Moghul here. We did quite a bit of a study of who would be the right person to have this, to lead us in this conversation. Did quite a bit of research about it, and came to the decision that basically he was the right person to do this. And I think you will see why we have made this choice. So on behalf of Abrahamic Initiative, I'd like to thank Haroon for coming. And again, I'd like to thank all of you for coming to this event. Your participation is really a testament to your commitment to interfaith dialogue and understanding, and that's truly greatly appreciated. So a quick introduction about Haroon, I've met Haroon yesterday for the first time. And truly, he has left a mark among all of those who were present at dinner last night with him to welcome him, both within Abrahamic Initiative Steering Committee as well as the organization that hosted the dinner last night, Muslims Intent on Learning and Activism. We truly found his company great value to us. Haroon Moghul is a fellow at the Institute for Social Policy and Understanding and a PhD candidate at Columbia University. Previously, he was a fellow at the New America Foundation and the National Security Studies Program and a fellow in Muslim Politics and Societies at the Center on National Security of Fordham Law School. He is senior correspondent at Religion Dispatches and columnist at the Muslim Observer. In 2013, he was a participant in the inaugural class of the Shalom Hartman Institute's Muslim Leadership Initiative. His academic research focuses on Allama Muhammad Iqbal's concept of reconstruction. His research more broadly includes Islam in India and Islamic networks across Greater Indian Ocean and West Asia regions. He served as Director of Public Relations for the Islamic Center at New York University and was selected one of 500 global Muslim leaders of tomorrow. He's a member of the Metropolitan Museum of Art's Multicultural Audience Initiative. He writes for a variety of media, including Boston Review, Guardian, Salon, and Foreign Policy. Haroon has spoken across the United States and internationally on Islamic history and culture, contemporary politics in the Muslim world, and radicalism and religious identity. Haroon has been widely published, including on the subject of today's talk. So without further ado, I present to you Haroon Moghul.
there are two types of people, Windows people and Mac people. I am neither. So we will be helpless. In all seriousness, if you look at the first slide, it tells you everything you need to know. So we'll just move to questions. No, I'm just kidding. Please wait. That's how it feels to be a Muslim sometimes. Just wait. Something will happen. First, just as a matter of, I suppose, housekeeping, for lack of a better term, you'll find note cards. Some of you may still be sitting on them. Others of you will have already found them. Those are for questions. So to make it easier and to make sure we have enough time for questions, we will basically be collecting the note cards and then reading out the questions, and hopefully we'll have time for all the questions. I urge you not to be in any way modest with your interrogations, shall we say. So please feel free to ask anything and everything. I will pretend to know the answer and deliver it as such. But seriously, if there's something I didn't touch on or needs to be clarified, please feel free and comfortable on asking whatever question you have. I've received every kind of question, probably many of the ones that are on the news, so I won't feel in any way uncomfortable with them. So today's talk is divided into four parts. My objective is to help you understand this word Sharia, which is so loaded and sometimes confusing. And basically, in these four parts, I will elaborate on what Sharia is and where it comes from. That's the first part. The second part is how Muslims negotiated Sharia in early Islamic history. The third part is the development of the classical Muslim societies and how they interpreted and understand Sharia. And the fourth part gets down to probably the topic that's of most interest to most people here, which is Sharia in the present, which includes Islam in America as well as Muslim communities globally. But we need to cover those first three topics in order to get to the fourth and final topic. So if it seems at times the history is a little heavy or dry or confusing, I apologize, and I promise to you that it will all work out in some way, shape, or form. These are really the questions that are animating this talk, right? What is Sharia? How did it evolve or develop? And why is it so contentious? And I want to make a very important distinction here. Whether or not you believe the formative period of Islam, the life of the Prophet Muhammad, was ideal, normative, divinely ordained, or simply human history as it unfolded, actually doesn't matter for this talk, right? If you're a Muslim, then obviously you will have a different perspective on it than if you were not Muslim. But that doesn't matter, because what I'm actually interested in is how what Muslims believe played out in history. So that is something that all of us can relate to, because all of us ask the same kinds of questions and go through the same kinds of historical processes. So the specifics might be unfamiliar, but the actual broad thrust of what I'm talking about should be familiar and relatable. So with that, I'll start with the first of these, which is basically situating Islam and the Prophet Muhammad. So the Prophet Muhammad is born in the year 570 AD. Which we know best, thanks to the way we're taught history, as basically the Dark Ages, right? It's like 2 a.m. in the Dark Ages. It's like the worst time of night, and if you're awake, you just kind of want to die, right? It's like the worst feeling in the world. You've watched everything on Netflix. You're thinking about that other movie, but really, do you want to be awake till 4 a.m., right? And then by 3 a.m., you know, Napoleon said there's two types of courage, 2 p.m. courage and 2 a.m. courage, right? Because the 2 p.m. courage is very different from the 2 a.m., I'm going to die alone and I hate my life kind of curve, right? So Islam is born when Napoleon said it would be. No, that makes no sense. Islam is born in a period that we generally as Westerners, as Americans, don't really register in our historical memory, because it's not particularly the best time in Western history, right? The Roman Empire has collapsed, and we're still a long way away from the Renaissance and the Age of Discovery and the Industrial Revolution. But this is the formative period of Islam. And the Prophet Muhammad is born in the western corner of Arabia in a town called Mecca, which you might be able to see, but basically it's on the western spine of the Arabian Peninsula, which is important for two reasons. First, because it's at the center of global trade routes, right? We all remember Christopher Columbus, right? Sailed the ocean blue. What was he looking for? India, why? Spices, why? Spices are important, right? He's looking to do what? Do an end run around Africa, and get directly to the source of the stuff that earns all the money. And even a millennium before that, it was still the case that many spices and many goods and many desirable products came from Asia into the Roman Empire and Persia. And Mecca was a city on this very important trade route. Goods basically came up. It's kind of funny because it's like the same human history, century after century after century. Goods come right to the mouth of the Red Sea, and they're loaded onto camel caravans, and they're basically marched through the desert, and they stop along the way, and then they arrive in the Eastern Roman Empire or in Persia. And Mecca is important because it's a city right there on that node, but it's also important because it's not part of those empires, it's not a capital, it's by no means a great world city, right? It's kind of on the margins of everything, and that's where Muhammad is born, in the year 570 AD, and he becomes a prophet in the Muslim belief in the year 610 AD, when he's 40 years old. If you know what The Walking Dead is. If you don't know what The Walking Dead is, you clearly haven't taken advantage of Netflix. So that's your fault. The reason The Walking Dead is a very interesting TV show, I think one of the reasons why we like apocalyptic TV shows is because they force us to really grapple in a very creative and emotional and powerful way with what is important. Who would we be without the luxury of security, of law and order, of a grocery store, right? What kind of people are we really when you take away all the comforts and advantages of life? And in a sense, right, but this is not the primary thing I want you to walk away with, right? Like, Muslims are not zombies. So that would not be the ideal. But in a sense, this is similar to existence in Arabia in the 7th century, right? You're living on the margins of the world's great powers. You don't have a lot of resources. It's not like there's ample agriculture, right? You don't have many days like this, right? You're in the desert. Basically, you're constantly hungry, and you're eking out a living. And Arabian society at the time was divided into tribes. These tribes often went to war with each other over limited resources. They had a sense of collective punishment and collective guilt. They were very classist. They were very patriarchal. And they didn't really get along. And they had no tradition of overarching states, right? This is not the Roman Empire, right? This is not Persia. This is clearly not the United States. You're living in what you might call a failed state, right? That's where Muhammad is born. And the reason this is important is because, you know, we say Islam is a religion, Judaism is a religion, Christianity is a religion, but we forget that religions evolve in specific circumstances, and those circumstances kind of become part of their DNA. So even centuries later, right, when the conditions have changed, that historical memory is still there, right? So this is basically where Muhammad is born, and it becomes his life mission as a prophet to not only preach a religion as we think of it in a spiritual sense, but to create a framework for the socially marginalized. Because Muhammad was born an orphan. His father died before he was born. His mother died several years after he was born. He went to the care of his grandfather. His grandfather died when he was 8. Then he went to the care of his uncle, right? Basically, he grew up in a society where anyone who was anyone, became who they were based on who their ancestors were and who their living relatives were. So Muhammad basically emerges in the society as a person who's marginalized, right? Who's poor and who's vulnerable because he doesn't have immediate family members to advocate for him. So this memory in his life becomes part of the mission of his life, is to build a society in which people don't have those advantages can have those advantages. Does that make sense? Right? So the idea is building a society where none exists. And how do you build a society where none exists, right? There's no template for it. There's no books, there's no libraries. It's not like you can, you know, hire a consulting firm and say, hey, what worked for you in this place? It's building something from scratch. That's what happens in early Islamic history. Now, in the Muslim tradition, Sharia is the way that you do this. Sharia literally means the path to the water. Now, if you live in a desert, the path to the water is what? Very important, exactly, right? It's critical. So the imagery should be obvious. If you follow the Sharia, if you walk the path to the water, you find salvation. In the Muslim belief, Sharia is composed of two sources primarily. The Qur'an, which Muslims believe is the word of God, right? And the sayings, actions, and values of Muhammad. The relationship between these two. Sorry, I know I like little baby pictures. That's kind of funny. I'll go back to the baby slide in a second. Muhammad embodies the Quran, and Muslims embody Muhammad. So the relationship here is, just very briefly, and I know there's a lot, but I promise I'll get through it. Muslims believe that the ideal person they should follow is Muhammad. And Muhammad, in turn, teaches them how to live out the words of the Quran in real-world circumstances. So here's a book. And here's the person who lives that book. And these two things in conversation with each other are Sharia. Make sense? That's Sharia. It's as if you said, here's the Bible, and here's how Jesus lives the Bible. Those two things are your Sharia. That's your revelation. That's your source of salvation. That is what you have to follow, right? Easier said than done. Couple major points here. Sharia is not Islamic law. It's not. The fact that many people, Muslims included, confuse the two is indicative of how bad the conversation is that we're having. Sharia is not Islamic law. It is also not that baby, but he's a cute baby, so it's okay, right? Sharia is revelation. Sharia is the Quran and the life of the Prophet Muhammad, which Muslims believe is divinely guided. Islamic law is what happens when human beings try to make sense of that revelation for themselves. Therefore, in the Muslim conception, Sharia is perfect, Islamic law is necessarily imperfect. So if you ask a Muslim, do you believe in Sharia? Pretty much every Muslim will say yes. And if you ask them the next question, what does that mean? They will probably never agree with each other. It's as if you were to take 100 Americans, put them in a room and say, do you believe in democracy? Probably all of them would agree, hopefully, right? And then you'd ask them what it means, and very soon, you'd have major disagreements, right? What does democracy mean in practice, right? It's a little bit like what's happening with Sharia. Sharia is revelation, and Islamic law is what happens when human beings attempt to understand revelation. Now, this is where we move to part two. After I show you a slide I've already showed you. Muhammad is often compared to Moses and Jesus as a foundational religious figure. But probably the more accurate analogy is to King David. He's a person of noble ancestry who is not a particular heavyweight in the society of his time, shall we say, right? People aren't looking at him and thinking, this guy's gonna be king, right? But he ends up assuming a prophetic and political role. But the problem is, Muhammad was not a political leader in the way that you and I think of political leaders. And Muslims are very aware of this. Because Muslims did not follow Muhammad because he was elected or because he was a king. They followed him because he was a prophet. Right? And Muslims believe Muhammad is the last prophet. So the prophecy starts with Adam, and it goes through Abraham, and Moses, and Jesus, and John the Baptist, and it goes to Muhammad, and then it ends with Muhammad. There's no prophets after him. Which is a problem. Because Muhammad built in his lifetime a political entity which was working because he was the prophet. And when he died, you had an immensely successful social institution that had for the first time unified the Arabs of the Arabian Peninsula into an overarching political unit who had no idea what to do next. Because by definition, none of them could presume his authority. This is the beginning of Islamic law. Islamic law begins when Sharia stops. When revelation ends, and Muslims have to ask themselves, okay, what do we do now? That's where Islamic law starts. Because if you had a question when Muhammad was alive, your belief as a Muslim was that you would go ask him. Easy enough, right? But when he's dead, what do you do? Who do you ask? How do you know? Becomes very difficult. So the first answer that comes up is that the caliphate will give you answers. The people who succeeded the office of Muhammad as a political leader end up expanding the state outwards. It's an expansion of power, not of religion. Those are two different things. This political expansion was not a conversion. It's very important to know, and I'll talk about it in more detail if you want. But very quickly, the caliphs became no different than kings. They passed power on to their children. They took all the trappings of the Roman and Persian empires that they had conquered, right? They lived in opulence and splendor. And the majority of Muslims said, this can't be it. This can't be the point of the whole thing. And we don't look at these kings, first in Damascus and then in Baghdad, right? We don't look at them as religious models, so they look to scholars. They looked to people who they believed were religious and moral authorities, and they did not look to those in political power. In fact, they found those in political power to be deeply corrupt and acting contrary to the purposes of religion. This is a common story in every community, right? people generally do not see politics as the repository of moral wisdom, right? Not like, hey, person who wants to rule everyone else, how do I become a good person, right? Like, that's just generally not how human societies have functioned, right? So although Islam expands politically, religiously it's in crisis. Because nobody has any idea who to look to for religious authority. And over time, within about a century or two, people identify a class that are called the ulama, scholars, learned. Basically people who studied revelation in and out, right? They studied Sharia, but, and here's the caveat, they also embodied it to the best of their ability. So it's not like being an academic, because you know, if you're an academic, let's say, you can study Buddhism, right? But it doesn't mean you're a Buddhist. You can know Buddhism in and out, but you may not actually be practicing it. What they were looking for was both. People who knew it and who lived it, because the belief was that knowledge went in both directions. You needed to know what the text said, but you needed experiential knowledge. Make sense? Those were scholars. And basically, scholars are the people who Muslims begin to look to for authority, Sunni and Shia. When they have questions, when they don't know what to do, when they're looking for guidance, when they're trying to settle a dispute, right? I'm reading the Quran and I read a passage and I don't understand what it means. And I don't know enough about it, so I'm gonna ask someone who does. And over the next century or two, these scholars begin to coalesce into schools of thought, right? Almost like medieval guilds. And they basically begin to attract students, and their students attract students, their books are published and spread far and wide, and they develop followings. And here's the key, it might have been seen as a failure at the time. I know, right? They actually, the ultimate revenge of the nerds, the final defeat of the jocks by the nerds was Google Glasses, right? We are gonna make everyone wear glasses. Right. So, you know, it had to happen eventually, right? History swings, right, between like muscle and brains. So these scholars are never able to agree on with each other on everything. Islam never develops a hierarchy or a church structure of any kind. Hamza Yusuf is a famous American Muslim scholar. He has a saying. He says, people who don't like organized religion should join Islam. We're the most unorganized religion. And if you're Muslim, you understand very painfully what that means from the start of your life till the end. Because there is no hierarchy. There is no central institution. It's a conversation between people over text. And they try, believe me, scholars try to develop a single methodology, a single mechanism, but they can't. And the reason why is because there's no more Muhammads. Nobody can decisively answer a question that is ambiguous, right? Because nobody has divine authority on their side. You can construct an argument, and maybe your argument will persuade people for 10 years or 20 years or 100 years or 200 years, but ultimately the belief remains that Sharia is perfect, Islamic law is not. Because Islamic law is only human beings attempting to understand Sharia. And the only person who could perfectly understand Sharia was Muhammad, because God guided him and told him what it meant. And now that he's gone, nobody can have his authority. And if you believe someone has his authority, then you believe that person's a prophet, and that's like the first no-no in Islam, right? Like, in Islam, one God, Muhammad is last prophet. That's it, right? That's it. Jesus in the Muslim belief is coming back at the end of time, right? But, like, unless you're claiming you're Jesus, right? Like, it's unlikely you have that authority, right? So, basically, you're stuck. There is no conclusive answer. It's a failure in one sense, but it's also a success in another sense. Because it enables Islam to be this very rickety, ramshackle, incredibly flexible, and surprisingly pluralistic structure. Make sense? If it doesn't, no cards. I apologize. Yes. These are basically the schools of thought. There's five. Four are Sunni, one are Shia. One's Shia. The Shia one is orange. It's basically centered on Iran and Iraq. I know we're American, we don't know where anything is. This is actually Game of Thrones. And that light blue is Middle Earth. It's a John Stewart, like 40% of Americans couldn't find America on a map of America. So, God bless us. So, you know, the interesting thing about these schools of thought is that they don't correspond with political units or empires. They often correspond to trade networks, because scholars were often merchants, business people, and as such, they, you know, they worked, and then they taught in their free time, and so their students traveled with them, and they spread. So East Africa, for example, follows the same school of thought as Southeast Asia, because there was massive and sustained trade for centuries between Southeast Asia and East Africa. Central Russia, for example, follows the same school of thought as Eastern Europe, as Bangladesh. Those units were never ruled by the same empires. This was not a theocratic movement. This was not, I mean, I'm not talking about secular democracy, obviously, I'm not talking about modern religion, but it was not theocracy. It was something kind of in between. And those are the schools of thought, and that's basically our second phase. That's what happens, right? That's the Muslim world round about the 1100s, 1200s, right? And then the Muslim world, in an academic sort of expression, gets its butt kicked by the Mongols in 13th century and gets nearly destroyed. So that's part three. I should probably talk to you about this awesome picture. I am related to neither of these people, just in case you're wondering. I don't have permission to use that image. I dare someone to do something about it. I'm just kidding. But one thing I want to clarify before I get to part three. The Muslim schools of law agreed on basically four things. What the sacred texts were, what the core beliefs are, and what ritual and worship are meant to be, with minor variations. And I'm talking basically across Sunni and Shia. They also agreed on this. I know, right? How can you resist? In the 1300s, a Spanish Muslim scholar named Shatibi was asked, what is the purpose of Sharia? And this is interesting, because some of these look familiar. He said, the purpose of Sharia is to protect and advance five things: life, property, religion, intellect, and family. Those are the overarching goals of Islamic law as it is interpreted, right? And so while Muslims agreed on these five goals, the debates came about because nobody knew how to order them in priority. So for example, right, let's say that you want to protect property, right? Because Islamic law historically is very much in favor of individual property rights, right? It is a very mercantile religion, it's a very commercial religion. But what happens if a property claim comes up against a claim that involves someone's life? How do you adjudicate between those two disputes? That is where interpretations of Islamic law are basically blown open. Because now you have no clear idea on what to do, and you have to figure it out for yourself. What happens if family and religion conflict? So for example, the purpose of Sharia is to protect family, but it is also to protect religion. What happens if a family member who is not Muslim has a claim in an inheritance? How does that work, right? These are all questions that were not necessarily clearly decided, right? What happens if a family member follows a religion that the early Muslims were not familiar with? What is the legal status of that religion, right? These are open questions, and you can think of a million other questions where, yeah, these five things are all important, but where the really interesting stuff happens is where they conflict, right? If you want to talk about it on a political level, right, many poor countries, as they modernize, nationalized industries, because they argued that in order to advance the country as a whole, they basically needed to have top-down industrialization. But how does that jive with a belief system that protects and advances private property? It's an open question. Make sense? And that basically led to where you had the areas of dispute. And this is where we get to the third phase. Around the 11 or 1200s, the Mongols basically sweep through the heartland of the Muslim world. So I'll go back to that map. Oh, sorry. So the Mongols basically come from way up there, like Mongolia, basically, and conquer a huge chunk of the Muslim world and destroy the heartland of classical Islamic civilization. They just kind of like wipe the floor with it. Baghdad, which was the capital of the Muslim world for 500 years, is burned to the ground. Somewhere on the order of a million people are killed, all the libraries are destroyed, It is like a catastrophic moment in Islamic civilization, not very dissimilar for Western civilization to the fall of Rome. It is the end of an era. And then about 100 years later, the Mongols do an interesting thing. They decide to convert to Islam. It's like, you guys, you really, like, you couldn't have just, you know, maybe, like, done that a little bit earlier and spared us a lot of problems, right? And they create the third great synthesis in sort of this Muslim history, where basically, look, if you're a conqueror, what do you want to do? Conquer, yes. That's what you want to do, right? You want to ride around your horse and kill people and, like, build your empire, right? Like, that's what makes your life meaningful, right? Some people watch Netflix. Other people are Alexander the Great, right? So that's what you want to do, is you want to conquer the world, right? But what do you need to conquer? Money. And where do you get money from?
Taxes.
Who said tax? Yes, taxes, the bane of human existence, right? Taxes, right? You have to tax people. But how do you tax people? You need a lot of information to tax people. Right? You need to know how much they earned. You need to know how many people are, like, who live there, right? You need to figure out what to tax on a property. You need to make sure that the people who are charging the taxes and collecting the taxes aren't skimming off the top, right? You have a problem. So the Mongols basically, you know, they're sitting around thinking, and their sort of descendant empires are thinking, how can we run this system more efficiently? Because simply burning everything to the ground and taking all the money only works for the short term, right? Because if you basically take all the money out of a society, it's not going to be producing any more money, right? So it's like nice for 1 year, and then it's kind of crap for like 5 years, right? So you want to do it in a more sustainable way, right? Like sustainable impoverishment, as opposed to like just sudden, abrupt transition to penury. So the Mongols basically, and their descendants, these classical empires, look and they find the scholarly class, right? They find these people who have dedicated their lives to the study of text, who have religious legitimacy, and who are numerate and literate. In other words, they find nerds, right? People who spend their whole lives reading books and answering religious questions. And they basically, you know, condensing a lot of history, come to basically an agreement that we will empower you to administer our territories, collect taxes, deal with disputes, serve as judges, and so on and so forth. And you will make sure our empires keep running efficiently. And the scholars say, well, what do we get out of it? And they say, not dying. And that's the deal. And so from about 1300 to 1700, 1800, this is what happens in a lot of Muslim societies. You have these military dynasties that rule these societies. They're focused on expansion and political gain and so on and so forth. But they are supported by an arrangement with the scholarly class that sort of benefits both sides in different ways. This is not theocracy, because power remains in the hands of the dynasties. It's not secular democracy, obviously, because these are monarchies, and I mean, the concept of secularism didn't exist. But it's somewhere in the middle. Generally speaking, leaves people alone as long as they pay their taxes. Doesn't demand they change their religion or convert, as long as they basically, you know, pay certain obligations to the state. And it produces these very powerful, very wealthy empires. For example, the Mughals ruled India from 1526 to the 1750s. At their height in the 17th century, controlled something like 30% of the world's gross economic output. Which is why Columbus was going to India, right? Because everybody knew that's where the money was, right? We've seen the Taj Mahal, right? You've probably seen pictures. These were incredibly wealthy, sophisticated societies. They ran efficiently, and they often survived for centuries. The most famous of them, the Ottoman Empire, was founded in 1299 and didn't expire until 1924. So these were incredibly powerful and stable and sophisticated societies capable of immense works in art and architecture and literature and philosophy and science, right? Many of them adopted gunpowder very quickly. They had advanced military, so on and so forth. And this was basically the third phase of Islamic civilization. And so I just like this picture because it's cute. She looked like almost too cute to be real. It's just such a funny face. Also, the book is larger than her. I have a niece now. She's like 9 months old. I realize how incredibly useless babies are. Like, they don't do anything, you know, like absolutely nothing. They're just a drain on everyone. But she's really cute, so it's kind of like worth it. Plus, when we're older, we're just gonna have to live off of them. So, you know, actually, you know, my father had time. He's sort of like pushing me. He's like, when are you gonna get grandkids? And so, just teasingly, I said, I don't want kids. I said, why should I have kids? And he was very, you know, he's very kind of horrified and astonished. And he said, why don't you want to have kids? And I said, well, I don't see the point. He's very quiet. He says, who's gonna visit you when you get old? It's like, that's why you had me? And he looks at me dead in the face, like there's no apology. He's like, who else visits me? Touche. So basically, this is how it worked from like 1300 to 1700, right? Religious institutions, state power, religious institutions from the bottom, state power from the top. Make sense? Kind of, sort of. That's how it works. It was like the circle of life. Scholars enable social stability. Social stability enables you to build endowments and institutions. Those in turn create more scholars. The scholars support the rulers. The rulers create the social stability that enables more scholarship, and it works. Now, there's really two things I want you to take away from this. Right? You can forget everything else. First thing is, it worked for a very long time in a lot of very different societies, and made these societies very wealthy and sophisticated and advanced for their time. This model was replicated in the 16th and 17th century everywhere from West Africa to Northern Russia, bordering the Arctic Ocean, mind you, to Southeast Asia, to East Africa. Persian was spoken in Bangkok. Muslims could freely travel from one end of this sort of cultural space to the other, despite the fact that it was broken up into competing political units. There was cultural and social mobility and unity. Anyone could become a scholar because it was a meritocracy. All that really mattered was how good you were academically, intellectually, spiritually, right? Didn't matter how much money you had, didn't matter what you were racially. There were thousands of female scholars as well, right? It was an achievement that endured and was replicated across the Muslim world. That's very important, I'll get to why later. The second thing is that none of this is actually in Sharia. Nowhere in the Islamic tradition did the Prophet Muhammad say, you shall establish scholars, who shall build alliances with rulers. Like, that doesn't exist. This was just something that Muslim societies figured out that they felt was organic to them, that was relevant to them, that was consonant with or consistent with their religious tradition, and worked. Right? It was a human response to a set of real social and material and economic and political conditions that worked for whatever reason, and that made people believe it was consistent with Sharia, even though it's not prescribed by Sharia. Do you see what I'm saying? Right? There's a difference there. It doesn't conflict with your religion, right? You can even say that you can draw it out from your religion, but it's not like it's written there for you to discover in your religion. Right? It took hundreds of years for this to emerge, and there was a lot of trial and error. Now, the reason those two things are important is because when it comes to what comes from Sharia, it means that the conversation is actually a lot more open than people think. And the fact that this was replicated everywhere had a perverse side effect, right? Because if something is really successful and is replicated everywhere, then what happens when it fails? It fails everywhere. And then you have a problem. Which is why so many Muslim communities and so many Muslim societies that otherwise so different from each other and historically so unconnected to each other seem to be suffering from the exact same problems. Because very similar forms of political systems collapsed, leaving similar kinds of challenges. Make sense? And that's where we get to the fourth phase, which is my hero. If you don't know what that is, shame on you. Your citizenship should be revoked. I really think they put Star Wars in the new citizenship test. Star Trek maybe, but you know, Star Trek definitely. Next generation, anyone? Some people are like, hey, it's X-Men. That's Commander Data in the background. Or Professor Data, I apologize. No, maybe. I was talking to a student once, and I mentioned Nirvana. You know sometimes when you're a little bit older and someone doesn't get something, you think it's like the end of Western civilization? This time was actually the opposite, right? Because I was like, Nirvana. And then she looked at me kind of confused, and she raised her hand, and she's like, you mean like Buddhism? And I was like, ooh, I actually kind of prefer that. But, you know, it's kind of funny. Exactly. So, you know, there's this common theme that you hear, like, Islam hasn't had its enlightenment or Islam hasn't had a reformation. The reason Islam didn't have the enlightenment is because the enlightenment's primary output to the rest of the world was colonization, right? It's kind of hard to get people excited about something that got them conquered, right? Like, people forget that, right? The enlightenment was experienced in different ways in different places. It made some people very rich and very powerful, and it made other people who were once rich and powerful very poor and weak, right? People call the Taliban and ISIS these anti-modern 7th century phenomena absolute nonsense. They are utterly modern phenomena because modernity has an upside and a downside. In every historical period, there are winners and there are losers. And the Muslim world was basically a loser. Muslim societies, and basically most societies in the world, right? I mean, come on, Native Americans, East Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, right? Were conquered. This is why in the year 1900, the majority of the planet was run by three or four countries. For as powerful as these Muslim societies were, the Ottomans, the Mughals, the Safavids, these empires of the sort of 16th, 17th, 18th century, they could not keep up with European modernity, so they lost. And they found themselves subjugated and defeated. That's the reality. That opens the fourth phase. This incredibly successful social contract, for lack of a better term, that existed for centuries, was overturned and overthrown by the advent of colonialism. Now, I'm not really interested in getting into the sort of the blame game, right? Because to me, that's kind of irrelevant at this point. It's just to understand historically why this happened, right? That's a map, the map doesn't lie, right? A country as small as the United Kingdom ruled 25% of the world's surface. It's a fact. And what happened in the process, and here I'm kind of obviously condense a lot of history, is that one of the first things colonial governments did when they came in is they basically undid the social contract between scholars and rulers. Because if you kill the rulers, right, which is what you do when you conquer someone, right? Like, when you lose, right, you are no longer a ruler, right? Like, that's kind of what happens, right? So once they lost power, the scholars lost their sources of support. And when they lost their sources of support, they lost the entire network that allowed them to sustain and reproduce themselves. It is as if we as a country were to be attacked and conquered, and whoever conquered us were to basically defund every single university in the United States. All the learning that we had would basically become inaccessible because the people who actually taught it to us are now gone. They don't have jobs, they don't have income, right? And they have no one to teach. So it is like another moment in Islamic civilization like the fall of Rome. The Muslim world experienced the Enlightenment very differently from how Western Europe experienced the Enlightenment. And this isn't exclusive to the Muslim world, it's pretty much, you know, par for the course for much of the world. When you read articles about China and American-Chinese relations, you often hear reference to the fact that the Chinese are, you know, quote unquote, very sensitive about foreign intrusions into their territory, which is firstly funny because who isn't, right? It's like, oh, those weird Chinese, right? Like, how strange, right? But secondly, you know, because that's what happened. China, which was once an incredibly powerful culture, civilization, and political system, was in the 1800s and 1900s basically a plaything in the hands of European powers. A historical memory that is incredibly powerful and resonant and painful. And what happened with colonialism is that those Muslim leaders who then emerged in the aftermath of colonialism were left facing a huge dilemma. In order to prevent themselves from repeatedly getting colonized, they had to develop military deterrence. But that meant that everything else had to go by the wayside. Right? They were single-mindedly focused on industrializing their societies and developing their societies in order to resist colonialism, which creates a really weird identity question, which basically comes down to, in order to prevent ourselves from being conquered, we must become like the people who have conquered us so they don't conquer us. That's kind of like, what does that even mean, right? That produces schizophrenia, like, basically, right? It produces massive cultural dislocation because you no longer know who you're supposed to be. And then you had another wave following colonialism of indigenous authoritarianism as leaders emerged who basically tried at breakneck speed to produce in their societies in 10, 20, or 30 years, changes that unfolded in European countries over 200 or 300 years. Right? To condense it, package it as if it's like a set of instructions and say, here, now you do this. See what I'm saying? Interestingly, societies that escaped direct colonialism generally were better at this. So Japan, for example, modernized independently of colonialism, rather successfully, probably too successfully based on World War II, right? Turkey escaped direct colonialism and is, compared to the wider Muslim world, far more industrialized. And Iran escaped direct colonialism and is, compared to the wider Muslim world, far more industrialized and powerful. Nevertheless, the underlying sort of theme emerged. And the reason this is interesting is kind of for two reasons. The first is that the whole edifice through which Muslims understood their religion was gone. Meaning you had a complete free-for-all. Which means that the very patient and scholarly and intellectual approach to your text and your tradition, which allowed you to live out your life in a spiritual and ethical way, is now gone, and you have no idea how to reproduce it. It's as if someone is saying to you, rebuild your civilization. It's a free-for-all. That's what we're seeing in the Muslim world right now. The reason there's so much violence in the Muslim world right now is not because Islam is inherently violent, right? It's for the same reason why you saw massive amounts of violence across Europe in the 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th century. Because an old social system was dying, and the new one had yet to be agreed on, and people were fighting out for whose vision would win. This happens in every society, in every part of the world, at crisis points. Right? We had a massive bloody civil war because we could no longer agree on what kind of country we were supposed to be, and we were willing to fight over it. Europe spent the first half of the 20th century fighting it out on an epic scale because the old monarchies weren't working, but nobody knew what was supposed to come next. And between monarchy and democracy, you had everything from fascism to communism. Because nobody knew exactly what was supposed to come next. It's a free-for-all. That is the Muslim world right now. Nobody really knows what the relationship between religion and state and society and identity should be in sufficient number to create a model that works that then attracts other people to it. Right? We are watching basically the dissolution and reformation of a society in a globalized era. Right? Where you can literally watch it like live tweeted. Right? So it's a little bit weird, but it shouldn't be too unfamiliar. The second reason this is interesting, is that we underestimate the degree to which many Muslim societies and communities have become comfortable with democracy. That is the world Muslim population. Muslims are actually, when you put us all together, we become a circle. It's amazing. Actually, we only exist in Microsoft Excel and PowerPoint. We are not Apple people. You know, Adam, Eve, Apple, bad. I was going to make some connection to Bill Gates and Islam, but I got nothing. Four Muslim countries compose about half the world's Muslim population. They're democracies. Not perfect democracies. They're pretty messy. They've got serious systemic problems, but they are democracies. They've gone through ups and downs, military coups, what have you, but they are democracies. India has one of the world's largest Muslim populations. It's a minority. It's about 130, 140 million people. Nirav Chaudhary once said the problem with India is the exception runs into the millions, right? So like 13% is like, you know, basically the population of the US like World War I, right? So, but these are people who are committed overwhelmingly to democracy and vote huge numbers in every election, right? They don't see any fundamental, right, incongruity between Sharia as it's interpreted and the ideal of democracy. And the final is Muslim America. That is the percentage of Muslims in the American population. I know people think like we're gonna take over the country. We've hit a rough spot. I mean, we have the president, but other than that. You didn't see that coming, did you? We didn't see it coming either. We still can't use shoe racks, right? We're like, how do we get the president? Like, shh, don't ask questions. Just take it if you got it. No, seriously. Muslim Americans are just a really interesting community Because we are the most ethnically diverse religious population in the United States, which is kind of wild. I live in Brooklyn. Within a few subway stops of me, there is a Pakistani mosque, a Turkish mosque, and a Polish mosque, right? Which is kind of wild, right? Like, that's kind of nuts. And we are the most ethnically diverse Muslim nationality in the world. If American Muslims were a separate country, like if you just took the 4 or 5 million of us and just listed us on those sort of GDP charts, right? We would be in the top 7 wealthiest Muslim countries in the world, which is nuts, because that includes countries like Saudi Arabia, right? So American Muslims are really well-to-do, higher educated than average, right? Very diverse, very divided, and very small. And American Muslims are an interesting population because on the whole, American Muslims represent, like America, an exception. And the reality is that for most American Muslims, right, the overwhelming majority are basically fine with being American. Their fundamental political debates have to do with whether you're on the right or the left. It's basically it, right? The only thing is that being a relatively young community, we've been here basically most of community members date to the 40s, 50s, 60s, right, being relatively young, we haven't really articulated what we already believe. We haven't developed the intellectual, shall we say, ammunition, great choice of words, Muslims ammunition, good. How do you destroy the Second Amendment? Just take a picture of a Muslim with a gun, and it's over, right? Muslims possess tremendous negative power, right? Like, we will endorse you or else, right? We could just like write Hillary Clinton a letter and be like, be careful. We will show up at all your rallies. And like wave. Like, I'm Muslim and I love Hillary Clinton. Yeah. What is up with that logo, by the way? It looks like a healthcare company. Like, maybe that was actually on purpose, but it's just, that's a really weird logo. I mean, come on, guys. There's a lot of money there, and they just made a big, like, H with an arrow. Like, you know, I would have made that. But I didn't, just to clarify. But American Muslims haven't articulated, right, in a sustained way, how they see their interpretation of Muslim life and American politics as fully consistent. Because we haven't been here for that long, and we haven't developed the sort of, shall we say, self-confidence to do that. But we will do that, because that's where American Muslims stand. And what that will mean is that over time, as different communities emerge in different places, they will have very different visions of what it means to be Muslim in a society, and what relationship religion should have to democracy, right? But that's really the unfortunate fact, is that we are confusing what is happening in the Muslim world today for something that is essential to Islam, as opposed to a very painful and sometimes very ugly historical process, right? And we miss the fact that most American Muslims really aren't that exceptional. They're just kind of American, pretty boring. I was in a mosque in Texas, and I had a rental car, and I was driving with a friend of mine who's also from Texas, and I was speaking there. And on the way out of the parking lot, some guy kind of cut me off. So, you know, being a New Yorker, I honked before it even happened. So we have the ability to time travel only in that respect. And he kind of like flipped out and said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Like, existing. It's what we do in New York. We just honk, right? Like, get out of our way. Time is money." And he said, "No, don't do that." I'm like, "Oh, why? Is it rude?" And he's like, "No, he probably has a gun." And I was like, "Oh, right?" But it was funny because, you know, like, it sounds like those are the real differences in American and Muslim communities, right? Have to do with the fact that American Muslims are a really tiny population that is really, really, really diverse, and that is fundamentally, you know, too small to not basically take on the color and character and idea and perspective and ideology of where it exists, right? Like 3, 4, 5 million people in a country of 330 million people is unlikely to maintain a cohesive identity. Actually, the irony of the whole thing is that the anti-Muslim sort of movement, the Islamophobia in the media, probably is creating an American Muslim identity. So thank you, Robert Spencer and Fox News. Because without you, we would have split up into like 500 groups and like happily like disappeared into America. I'm being totally serious, because in the absence of an external push, like an external feeling of threat or being opposed, a community this diverse would never be able to sustain this kind of identity. Case in point, in 2000, the American Muslim community split almost exactly down the middle when mostly African-American Muslims endorsed Al Gore and most immigrant origin Muslims endorsed George Bush. Right? That was like, that was not very long ago, right? The last election, about 92% of American Muslims voted for Obama. That's not necessarily because 92% of American Muslims are Democrats. It's because the overwhelming majority of Muslims don't believe that they have a home on the right. And if the Republican Party were to sort of open the door to a community that is very often very socially conservative, the Muslim community would probably split in half. Those are the really interesting divides I find in the American Muslim community. The reality of extremism and all that, that's not a reality, but in terms of an everyday concern, I don't think it's really there. So what I hope I did in doing this, and I hope I haven't taken too much time, is to give you this overview and to really hopefully help you leave with this takeaway, that what American Muslims and Muslims generally are doing is attempting to relate their text to their circumstance. It's no different than any other community does at any point in time. And societies in crisis often find more radical voices, and that's a reality. And I'd be happy to talk about that, you know, in more detail in terms of where it's coming from, what it does, how to combat it, how we should approach it, how it might affect us. But ultimately, I think when it comes to American Muslims, those are not the questions we should be asking. The questions about American Muslims have a lot more to do with American politics and American societies and where this reasonably fast-growing but small and diverse, talented and well-to-do community will go. And that, to me, says a lot about the shape of America. In other words, will American Muslims be more like American Jews or American Christians? Those are really the interesting questions. Will American Muslims split up around secular identity or cultural identity or religious identity? Will they split between progressive and conservative? All those things have already happened and are already happening. They just haven't really come to the fore because our conversation about American Muslims, by and large, continues to confuse us with what is happening on the other side of the world. So thank you very much. Have a great rainy Denver day.
Someone noticed your slide that talked about Sufi revolts, and you're being asked to elaborate perhaps on Sufi scholarship and what we were referring to on the question of revolts.
Sure. So probably many of you have heard the word Sufi. Sometimes Sufism is presented as different from Islam. Really, Sufism is basically just a movement within Islam to basically help people become more like Muhammad through spiritual techniques. It's kind of like being part of a guild or an order. And until very recently, most Muslim scholars were also Sufi scholars. The relationship was deeply intertwined. And until probably about 100 or 200 years ago, the idea that Sufism and Islam were really two different things would have been inconceivable. What I should have elaborated on and didn't because I didn't have time is that when colonial forces first arrived in the Muslim world, they first defeated the political dynasties' elites and disestablished them from power. The next wave of revolts was usually led by the scholarly class. They were sort of the next sort of pillar of the old order, and they were then defeated. So what that meant is that you had societies that had lost their political structure and then had lost their intellectual and spiritual structure, creating basically a situation in which many people may have identified strongly with Islam, but had lost the institutions and people to teach them the religion, which created a vacuum. And it is into this vacuum over the last several decades groups like ISIS have emerged. I don't doubt that ISIS is Muslim, right, or that they believe they're Islamic. Like, obviously they are, right? They are quoting the Quran. They believe they are Muslim. They articulate what they're doing through Islam, right? Like, none of that is debatable. It's not like they're literally making up Quran. But the interesting thing is that when Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, who is the ISIS caliph, declared himself caliph, right, every single Muslim, like, he actually was the first person to unify the Muslim world to this extent. Every single Muslim group in the world has condemned ISIS, including groups that cannot stand each other. Even Al-Qaeda has condemned ISIS for being too extreme, right? Which is sort of like you never thought you'd see that day when Al-Qaeda's like, no, you're killing too many people. Which is itself kind of alarming too, because as a Muslim, you sometimes think like, how much worse can this get? That, you know, every 10 or 15 years, it seems like there's something even worse on the horizon. But the reality is that a group like ISIS is able to emerge. Because it's taking advantage of a vacuum. That's not to say that they don't bear responsibility for what they're doing, but it's the same thing as saying that were it not for the onerous obligations placed on Germany after World War I, there would probably be no National Socialism. That doesn't mean the Nazis were literally crazy and evil, right? But it does mean that political conditions were conducive to their rise. You see what I'm saying? And so in that vacuum, groups like ISIS have emerged. So when I mentioned the Sufi revolts, what I simply meant is that you have this sort of sustained process of basically social deconstruction, which then opens the door for more radical movements. And then, you know, you see what you see today.
Thank you. There were a number of questions about ISIS and jihad and such. Is there anything you want to add to what you just said? You said something interesting last night. It was more advice to Muslims about how to deal with this question head on, and also taking an end run around it. I'd like to elaborate on that a little bit.
Sure. So ISIS is not a religious movement in the way that it's characterized. It is a religious identity movement. And this is important to understand because it's important to understand how to defeat a group like ISIS. If you watch ISIS videos, and actually I don't recommend you do this, you probably don't want to type in ISIS videos on your browser, especially if you are Muslim, right? Like, do it in the public library, it's okay. But, you know, in all seriousness, these are things that people in positions of authority in Muslim communities should be watching, because they should understand what is being said. I'll basically make two comments. The first is the way ISIS appeals to young people is by constructing a narrative of victimization and empowerment. All these bad things have happened to Muslims. They have a very simple explanation, and they have a very simple solution, right? Everyone is using violence against us. We have to use violence against them, right? It doesn't talk about religiosity in the way we would understand it. It doesn't make moral demands, it makes political demands, right? Islam is not ethnically defined like Judaism, but it does create a sense of peoplehood, and that can be exploited, right? Like anything else in the world, it can be used for good or for evil. And what groups like ISIS do is they play on a sense of powerlessness, and they use it to attract people who are vulnerable. Now, this has nothing to do, amazingly enough, with poverty. People think that people are attracted to extremist groups because they're poor or marginalized. Not true. We don't know, like, it's not a science, right? Human beings cannot be deconstructed that way. But many times people are attracted to these groups because they feel a sense of moral obligation, right? Basically what ISIS says is your people are being killed and you have a responsibility to do something about it. The thing about ISIS that makes them more dangerous is that, like, unlike previous extremist groups, they are committed to building a state, right? Al-Qaeda would reference ideologically the idea of a caliphate and some future outcome, but they didn't really have a practical ideological vision. They weren't like Marxist-Leninists, right? They didn't build cells in the interest of really establishing a state, right? They thought that would come somewhere down the road. I'm not even sure if they were really thinking about that or interested in it. ISIS, on the other hand, plays on this idea of victimization, right? And basically pulls people in that way, right? They create this narrative, and then they use it, and this is why you find people of vastly different social circumstances traveling to join ISIS, right? And not to mention there are certain base human motivations, right? There are some really bad people in the world, like that's just reality. Like, I don't believe everything comes down to simply misunderstanding, right? If you tell young people, as someone was mentioning last night, you know, we will give you a gun and you can kill anyone you want and you can have lots of women and power, that will appeal to people. Historically, we know obviously it has. That's a reality. But ISIS as a religious identity movement is dangerous for that reason. But I don't think we should overreact, because I don't think it's an existential threat, right? Because it's too extreme to sustain itself. It's sort of like Nazi Germany, just without any industrial capacity, right? Nazi Germany attacked everyone, right? You know, if you're familiar with World War II, you would probably say, like, why would the Nazis in the middle of worrying about Western Europe go and attack Stalin after they, you know, basically had a treaty with them, right? But they just wanted to conquer everything. ISIS has basically unified everyone in the Muslim world, which is an incredibly fractious place, against them. The reason that more people aren't able to fight back against ISIS is the unfortunate fact that many of the groups that are fighting ISIS are just as bad, right? So ISIS emerged in the context of a civil war against Bashar Assad in Syria, right? Bashar Assad's Syrian government, which is a secular socialist government, has killed far more Sunnis than ISIS has, right? So how do you realistically take sides in that conflict? You don't. You either keep your head down for fear of being killed, or you get the hell out. And that's the problem, is that nobody really finds the forces that are fighting against ISIS to be sufficiently compelling to sacrifice one's life for. Right? It's as if the only forces are fighting are like, you know, Stalin's and Hitler's. Right? Like, which one do you want? Like, neither. That's part of the problem when it comes to confronting ISIS and why it seems like there isn't the pushback that you would expect or imagine.
Thank you. There are a number of questions that have to do with Muslims reconciling their religion or the practice of their religion with a secular context in which to do that. There's a specific question here that gets at that in another way. Quoting the chair of the board of the Council of American Islamic Relations, who apparently said, "Islam isn't in America to be equal to any other faith, but to become dominant." Would you care to compare, contrast, relate using those polar questions about secularism and practice of faith?
That's a tough one. There are some Muslims who I think would articulate Islam and secularism as opposed, because especially in the last 100 years, there has been a movement, again in a vacuum, to see Islam as a political ideology as opposed to a spiritual, religious, ethical system. And there hasn't been a lot of pushback against that within Muslim communities. The long-term pushback will come from communities that exist within secular systems and defend them. For every one Muslim who says something like that, I can think of dozens who work in government or in the armed forces and seem to have no compunction with that. But again, a lot of this is borrowed from a conversation abroad, which is imported here. And the reality is that American Muslims, I think, haven't done enough to really articulate why their practice of Islam here is fully consistent with Islam. American Muslims sometimes continue to have an inferiority complex vis-a-vis the Muslim world, in the belief that because they live as minorities, they can't be authentically Muslim. And it's sort of a complex that you hear. I mean, I was at a conference in the Middle East, which grouped together young Muslim leaders from, you know, the West and the Muslim world. And they actually had to do a panel on why you could be a good Muslim in the West. And I pulled my friend aside and I said, who was one of the organizers, said, well, this is kind of ridiculous, right? Like, why are you having this panel? And he said, no, it's not for the Western Muslims. It's for the ones from the Muslim world who don't think you can be Muslim in America. Partially, this also has to do with perception. A number of Muslims in the Muslim world believe that Muslims in America are oppressed. Oppressed, yeah, like treated like horribly. Because the reality is many of our perceptions of each other come from the media. Every time you watch a news segment, including my own on 9News, on Islam, you just see terrorists. And when you watch news about America in the Muslim world, you overwhelmingly see how most people in the world process America, which is drone strikes and bombs. Many people I know very well in the Muslim world are convinced that America is a lawless, violent place, full of racist cops and everyone who has assault rifles and everyone's trying to kill everyone. That's all they see. And they literally don't understand how I could live here and be comfortable. Because their perspective of America is filtered through what they see, right? It also doesn't help that if they watch American TV shows, it also kind of seems like there's like a constant, like, you know, chase scene like for 10 minutes, right? Like, life is a lot less interesting in America than it is on TV. But that's a problem because that's the only contact you get. And the problem we have then is that there are very few Muslims in America. So there's very little exposure for Americans to Islam. And for most people in the Muslim world, their primary exposure to America is television, media, and foreign policy. It's not really to America generally or broadly. So again, you get skewed perceptions. As to that opinion perspective, like personally, I would reject that outright.
There's lots of questions here that deal with Sharia and Sharia law. I mean, you may not have convinced some people that there's a difference between Sharia and the interpretation of it as a system or body of laws. There's one question here that I think puts it succinctly. According to this person, most Muslim scholars would disagree with your characterization of Sharia as not Islamic law and what it embodies in terms of obligations of Muslims or for Muslims. Why do you seek to deflect attention away from the violent interpretations that suffuse the Quran and rule behavior under the doctrines of a, I can't read the word.
Abrogation.
So that's one way of putting it. Other people are asking, well, let's leave it at that. I think it's like,
You know, a lot of the violent interpretations that exist, first of all, I don't believe Islam is a religion of peace. I've said that before. I don't believe almost any religion is a religion of peace, other than perhaps, like I said, Jainism. There's no religion I can think of that doesn't articulate violence in some form. Judaism, Christianity, Buddhism, Hinduism, that exists. Violent interpretations of the Quran exist. Abrogation is generally misunderstood. If a verse in the Quran tells you to do something, it doesn't mean you have to do it. 99% of lay Muslims don't actually know that. Because unless you read the entire tradition as a whole, you would, within 5 minutes, be confronted with contradictory evidence. Because the Quran frequently contradicts itself, like any religious text. So the reason you had the development of scholarship in early Islam was that people very quickly saw contradiction. And so they asked themselves, how do we reconcile these things? And they developed a system for reconciling these things. That system has gone away. But religious text itself is not the only source of violence in the world. So if you remove religious text, right, even if you change religious text, it doesn't mean you remove violence. Right? People will twist a text whatever way they want in order to produce violence. That's a reality. Right? When ISIS is condemned by every single major Muslim group, what do they say in response? We don't recognize your authority to interpret the text. But what do you do with that?
What about Iran?
Again, the first instance in which clerics ruled a society in Muslim history was Iran. Ever. That's the first theocracy in Muslim history. Never before has it happened.
And it was questioned by a number of...
But the reason I think it's important, and the reason I think it's actually very important is because modern Muslim societies, when they transitioned from agrarian societies to modernizing societies, did the exact same thing European societies did, which was they began to unite church and state. We forget that church and the separation of church and state in our constitution, right, doesn't come from 1,000 years before. It comes from the few centuries immediately before our revolution when very powerful states were created that demanded religious adherence to the religious faith of the leader, right? Because the Treaty of Westphalia mandated what? The religion of a state will be the religion of its leader, right? And that very quickly produced religiously oppressive societies. Right? This is the reality, right? Because this is the problem I have with Muslim conversations, with Muslims who are talking about Sharia. Just because the Quran says you have to do something doesn't mean you have to politically enforce it. Right? That is something that many Muslims have decided to do in the last century or two, and I don't agree with it. You see what I'm saying? Right? Just because Sharia says you have to do X, Y, and Z doesn't mean the state then has the authority to enforce your doing it. That itself is an innovation and it's an argument. And what you're seeing right now, and it's not an easy answer. There's no like easy answer like, let's just, you know, what you're seeing right now is an argument between arguments for whose vision will win. That's the reality. Now, in the United States, it's almost irrelevant because most Muslims have basically wholeheartedly embraced where they live. If you ask most Muslims in the United States, would you rather go elsewhere? Nobody's gonna say yes, right? And the evidence of it is clear from the fact that nobody leaves. Right? Very few, right? The number of people who are trying to come in far outweighs the number of people who are trying to leave, right? What does that say? That's voting with your feet, right? You can tell me all day, right, within the Muslim community that X, Y, I mean, you hear all these Muslims say, America's bad, America's bad, America's bad. Then, you know, like, I mean, I was taking Persian classes at the Iranian Cultural Center in Pakistan. I was living in Pakistan for a semester to study languages for my PhD. And the guard there, you know, once he saw an American passport, was pretty, shall we say, short with me, right? And, you know, he was kind of giving me a hassle just even trying to get into the building. And then when I came out and I was leaving, he called me back in. And he asked me how he could get a visa to America. Right? The reality is that people vote with their feet. Right? Where are people going? Right? Yes, several hundred people, several thousand people have joined ISIS. There's no argument there. That's a reality and that's a problem. But hundreds of thousands of people are going the other direction. Right? The problem is that the arguments right now don't have the same force, because how do you have an argument with someone who just wants to kill you? Problem. It's like saying to someone, like people in Pakistan, like, why don't you fight the extremists? It's like saying to someone, go disarm your neighborhood gang. Like, that's not an easy position to take. We have the luxury of law and order and a functioning government. In the absence of it, you're at the mercy of predatory individuals. And they will do whatever they can to enforce their power. Right? Who is the primary leadership of ISIS? The Ba'ath Party. When they were Sunni and secular in Iraq, they committed genocide. When they're Shia and secular in Syria, they commit genocide. And when they're Islamist and religion between Iraq and Syria, they're still committing genocide, right? Like, constant theme here, genocide, right? The Ba'ath Party created ISIS. And some young Muslims are stupid enough to fall for it. They think they're going to serve the caliphate or for glory or victory or whatever, and they're basically Saddam's useful idiots. That's the sad fact, that they are manipulated, and whether they believe it sincerely or what, like, you can never break it down, but they basically are being used, right? ISIS's core leadership is former Ba'ath Party officials. How else can you explain how a group suddenly learned how to conduct, like, large-scale military maneuvers, hold territory, build a state, issue passports? Random dude on the street or cleric in the mosque is not going to know how to do that. Right? ISIS was created by basically hangers-on from Saddam's odious regime, right, who were looking for a way to unify Sunnis because they can't accept that a democracy in Iraq means they will be a permanent minority. But, I mean, with respect to the interpretations, it's just a battle of ideas at this point, with real consequences. There's no other way to put it. It's no different than what you saw in Europe in the 1930s. What is Western civilization? Is it communism? Is it fascism? Is it democracy? It's what it is. That's where the Muslim world is right now. It's fighting a battle of ideas. Whose vision will win out? And it's not particularly, like, heartening, because there's no, like, I can't say in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, this is what you'll see. But that's where it is.
What do you think? What do you hope?
I'm staying here. Peace out.
There's a lot of questions about practice, and practice as it's perceived, being prescribed by the Quran or by the Hadith. And do American Muslims differ in their practice from Muslims elsewhere? And how do you see the understanding of that practice evolving? There are clearly people writing questions who are concerned about what they use the oppression of women or other kinds of laws that might show a bias towards Muslims as opposed to non-Muslims and so on and so forth.
Sure, sure. Pew did a breakdown of American religious communities and gender equity in pay and education. The most gender equal religious community in the United States is Jewish. Second, Muslim. That's the reality. The institutions haven't caught up to it yet, but American Muslim women tend to be far more educated than American women on average, and generally enjoy far greater levels of pay equality than other religious communities, barring the Jewish community. Does that mean there's not patriarchy in the Muslim community? No, of course not. It just means the two things that are contradictory can be true at the same time. When I speak on college campuses, I see generally far more women than men. That's the trend within the United States generally, that women are outpacing men educationally, academically, and that's true in the American Muslim community as well. In terms of, you know, are women oppressed in American Muslim communities? No, I think a lot of them find communities to be unwelcoming to women, and they usually just check out. The bigger problem you find in a lot of religious institutions in America is people just don't attend because they don't find anything there that speaks to them. This is a problem in American communities beyond just gender, where you don't have indigenous religious infrastructure, right? So you go to a mosque and you're like an educated person, you've worked hard in your life, you're doing well for yourself, and then the person who's talking to you isn't really on your level, shall we say, right? Isn't capable of reaching you where you are. Most people just stop going. That's a reality. But there are immense changes in communities. Like 20 years ago, it was very rare to find women in leadership positions. Now it is very common. When I was at in an MSA, a Muslim Student Association, I was there from like 1998 to 2002 at NYU. You know, we actually made it a point to kind of mandate positions for women to like create basically equality, and then hopefully it becomes habit, right? To basically like force it. Now I go to college campuses where most of the leadership position in clubs is female. This has all happened in the last 10 years. The scale of the shift is actually pretty phenomenal. But it's across the board. I've been to communities where men and women are in absolute segregation, and I went to one community where the MSA Muslim Student Association president was the non-Muslim girlfriend of some Muslim guy. Right? Which is like, you know, like, but that's what I'm saying, is like, you know, most of these communities are fundamentally American. I found rates of child abuse, sexual abuse, to be generally not very different than what I find in other communities. The problem is that we don't talk about it as much, and we don't really have resources for it. The bigger problem comes in with people who have recently arrived, who are more easily victimized, and who are more easily manipulated. So I'll give you an example. New York City has a very large population of Muslims who have recently arrived, right? Many of these folks, their parents come here for a better life. They work one or two jobs. They have insane hours. They don't really speak English. And they don't know what their kids are doing. And they're probably deathly afraid that their kids are using drugs or start screwing around, and they just want their kids to study, go to college and get a good job, right? And then their kids spend all their time online, they have no idea what their kids are doing. And the society in which they grew up, if their kid says they're spending more time at the mosque, that's a good thing, right? It's like volunteering at your church group, right? Now they have to worry about radicalization. And they don't know what to do about it because they're like technologically illiterate. Right? I mean, you have no idea what your child is doing on a computer, and now you gotta worry about this on top of it? That's really hard. But the fact of it is that if you look at American Muslims who have radicalized, who have left to join ISIS, the overwhelming majority of them, right, almost all of them did it through the internet. None of them did it at a mosque. None of them did it at a Muslim school, right? Because that gets shut down immediately. The only place they can find an outlet for this stuff is online. But that's also a problem because it means it's harder to see. So how do you strike a fine line between rejecting extremism but leaving enough room open so that if someone has a question or a problem or they're vulnerable, that they can talk to you? And that is a national security and counter-radicalization challenge, right? Because, you know, I'm not worried that 99% of young Muslim kids are going to be tempted to radicalization. I'm worried about that one angry loner kid, right? And that kid is going to be the last kid who wants to talk to me because, like, I've worked with the U.S. government. So from his point of view, I'm a sellout, right? Like, I am the enemy. So he's not going to talk to me. You see what I'm saying? So it becomes a challenge. So you have to create some mechanism where basically you have a chain, right? Where you have people who basically are far enough away from institutions of power that they can be trusted by people who are on the margins, but nevertheless can talk to people in power when there is a problem. On a few occasions I've had to do that, I'm sure other people have had to do that in the past, where they've encountered sort of very unsavory folks in the mosque, but literally the number of instances that has happened to me is about two or three times. In terms of oppression of women otherwise, I mean formally, systemically, no, doesn't happen. Not in any way unusual or any different I've seen than other communities. Not talking about the Muslim world generally, talking about the United States.
One last question. What do you hope for in terms of the future of Islam, the future of Muslims in this country? Play with that.
I want the new Star Wars movie to be good. That really bothers me. By the way, the new Star Wars movie is the perfect analogy to reform in Islam. You all heard of Ayaan Hirsi Ali? Yeah, right? She's an absolute disaster. You know why? Because no one trusts her. If you actually want, even if what you're saying is right, if nobody trusts you, you're not going to get anything done. Right? It is as if America faces a major problem, let's say, in national security, and the person who's bringing it to you is a person who's been hating on America and wishing for its destruction for the last 20 years. Are you going to listen to that person? Probably not. You're not going to trust him, right? So a woman who's basically spent the last 10 years saying she wishes Islam were to be destroyed, now saying she wants to reform it, isn't going to get anywhere because she has no street cred. Nobody listens to her, right? The right analogy is to J.J. Abrams. You got to reach a point in your career where people trust you with like the most sacred enterprise of all, redoing Star Wars, right? And if that's a serious job, imagine, I'm being very serious here. I'm actually not being flippant, right? That's what it takes to create a vision of Islam that is fundamentally compelling. You have to go back to the original. You have to know what it is draws people in. You have to understand what connects it to people, why people love it and defend it and care about it. And yet you have to create it in a manner that is relevant to the modern age, right? That takes a level of trust that most of these so-called people on media don't have. If you want to know why you shouldn't listen to them, it's because they're wasting your time and your money, right? A lot of our war on terror is like the war on drugs. It's been how many years, and we have more terror and more war. It failed. We went from Al-Qaeda to ISIS. Why? Because we listened to the wrong people. I'm not talking to you as a Muslim. I'm talking to you as a fellow American. We, in the last 14 years, have spent something on the order of $1 trillion of our money for what? Thousands of Americans have died for what? Are we safer? Have we solved the problem? So why are we listening to these people? They're wasting your money and your time, and they're putting all of us at risk. They're not making us safer, right? We overreacted to 9/11 because radical Islam is dangerous, but it is not an existential threat. Please don't buy the narrative that a bunch of hangers-on who have no institutional, industrial, or national capacity, no real ability, threaten the Western order. We are the most powerful nation in the history of the world. If we are scared of Iran, there's a problem, right? We fought the Nazis, who were the most militarily advanced nation in the world, while we were fighting the Japanese, right? And we're talking about Iran as a threat to the United States? Are you kidding me? Like, that's what we've come to? It's fear-mongering, right? There is a problem with radical Islam, I don't doubt it. There is a danger with radical Islam, don't doubt it. But the worst thing we can do is overreact, because that exacerbates the problem, right? ISIS is largely contained. One of the interesting debates in national security right now is whether or not we should let people go, right? Because if they go, they're not doing something here. And that's not, I'm not saying this point just like as if it's like a cure-all. I'm just saying literally, what do you do? If someone is basically saying, I want to attack people here or go over there and fight, what is better from a national security point of view? Right? These are the conversations we should be having. These broad, sweeping generalizations are not doing anything for anyone. And when it comes to actual American Muslims, you know, we are in the middle of developing an identity and a framework, and it's very early in the game, right? But the overwhelming narrative of American Muslims is not the narrative that you see in the rest of the world, largely because our circumstances are American, our interests are American. And what I am seeing that I'm very positive about and what I hope for is that more and more young Americans aren't buying this narrative, the quote you mentioned from the executive director of the organization, are rejecting that, and they're rejecting extremism, but they realize that it's not enough to reject extremism. Right? That's a stopgap. What you need to do is construct something better. Right? Because I can talk till my face is blue about what's wrong with ISIS, but that fundamentally doesn't address the conditions that produced it, and it's not going to compete with it, and it's not going to drown it out. I have to invest my time and energy in building institutions and narratives and ideas and leaders who will then create momentum to push back. And that's a very slow process, it's a very painful process, it's a very boring process, right? But that's the only thing that's going to work. And the thing that gives me hope is that more and more young Muslims I see are going into careers they never would have otherwise, like journalism, media, law, government, armed forces, because they want to be part of society, they want to engage, they want to push back against extremism, and they want to contribute, right? They wouldn't have done this 10 or 15 years ago because they wouldn't have felt compelled to do it. And it's those people in that generation in the next 10 or 20 years who I think are going to produce the real good. Does that satisfy me right now? No. Is it going to satisfy you right now? Maybe not. But rest assured that, you know, it's not a static situation, and there's a lot more people pushing back and doing things that you realize. It's just that, you know, the kind of work we do is not sexy. It doesn't get on the news. It's not exciting or interesting. It's not going to make for a good segment, and it's not going to be a YouTube video. But that's the reason why it's so important. Thank you very much.